اعوذ باللہ من الشیطان الرجیم بسم اللہ الرحمن الرحیم السلام علیکم جی آیا نو پخیر آگلے نی ہاو چونو شب میں وش ملے اوہائیو گزائیمز گوٹر موگن اولا بونجو پریویت کیفا حال حال شما چطورے اہلا وسار مرحبا بونا موچو گراسیا سفابی اب بلی کرے آیا ہوش گیال دن نایو سایو خویا مورا چی متو چی حال جود کالی میرا خیر اتان and a very warm welcome to everybody who's tuned into PTV World and watching World This Morning. Now, except my very well-learned colleague who happens to be Ms. Haja Sati, I happen to be Shahzad Ehsan Khan, and we hope and pray that everybody out there is doing wonderfully well and that you're ready to kickstart your day with us. But first thing first, hello Haja, assalamu alaikum. How are you feeling today?
Walaikum assalam. Thank you so much, Jazakallah Khair, for introducing me. It is very cold in Islamabad, and for the past few days, we are witnessing a very plummeting temperatures. But having said so, I think it has been, I don't know, more than 3 or 4 months since we last witnessed the rain, and we want the rain to happen.
Yeah.
And when we talk about the rain, when we talk about the weather condition, our Balochistan, our province, the biggest province, is experiencing extreme plummeting temperatures, and it is extremely cold over there. And I think we can say the same about Islamabad, because I was driving from home this morning to my office place and I could not see anything. It was zero visibility. I was driving with the double indicators on, and the fog, you can certainly feel the effects of the fog, especially climbing into your spine. It is that much cold here. But we hope and pray that after the rain, things get to start some better and we get to see the end of this very dry winters, because you find every other person falling sick.
True.
Either they have sore throat or they have fever or they have temperatures, and it is thriving, especially in the closed spaces, especially in the schools, especially in the, households or all of the places. So be careful and make sure that you take proper precautions before you move out, because it is extremely, extremely cold. And this cold also reminds us that the sun is such a wonderful blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And after, I think, 10 or 11, when the thing starts to get clear and when we observe the sunlight, it is such a blessing to feel the warmth of the sun. And it is almost free, right? It is free. The warmth of the sun is free. And this is the biggest blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
And in addition to that, you know, obviously, so first of all, ladies and gentlemen, we always speak about how, you know, you really need to kind of hold the rope of gratitude, always be very thankful to Allah Almighty. But imagine that we have not been able to sit under the sun and eat our kinnus. I think the oranges, because that's something.
Or peanuts.
Yeah, because that's something which happens to be like a national game for Pakistanis in winters as well. Climbing up to your rooftop, making sure that you sit under the sun, that, you know, you feel the warmth, you know, have some oranges as well, some kala namak alongside that.
Vitamin D, the dose of vitamin D, the citrus, or in the sunlight, you know.
Exactly. So, ladies and gentlemen, I think that we've been unable to experience that these winters as well. But not just that, I think when we speak about climate change, there's one more request for all of those people, you know, who are running schools. And that is that because of climate change, there's always a shift in the weather that we see. Now, the cold weather might be a prolonged cycle. When we talk about summers, that's how it was. So we really need to kind of adjust the winter vacations for kids.
Of course,
imagine my 4-year-old daughter had to wear 2 pairs of gloves, 4 inner layers, then a jacket, and then, you know, sending them to school. Imagine that they're saying, Daddy, I'm too cold. So please, for everybody who's out there, if we can readjust, reshuffle, we really need to do that for the betterment of the kids, so that they don't fall ill as well. But when we talk about climate change, the impacts are global. And unfortunately, I think this chaos is man-made itself as well. Imagine just very recently when we talk about the plummeting temperatures, you know, I think that the United States of America, maybe Canada, the Arctic breeze has actually made it really difficult for them to survive over there, because it's just getting so cold and they're naming it Arctic blast. So imagine that the causes of climate change are now causing havoc for people to live and the way they were living, unfortunately, just before that as well. So I think for everybody who's out there, we really need to kind of talk about it. We have some visuals all the way from US and Canada and how cold it has gotten over there. So imagine that those roads where you actually drive, people are skiing on top of that as well.
And
people have gotten out.
And I think this is wonderful, that how people start to enjoy the winters there, because winter snowstorms continue to bring dangerous conditions to America. We have seen that how the electricity has been disrupted, the social life has been disrupted. There is a cut off of, the road infrastructure, because there is such a heavy snow. And there are freezing and dropping temperatures, especially in the American continent. But we see, especially in the Canada and especially in the upper parts of the America, that these temperatures are dropping as low as to minus 50-55 degree. And in summers, especially the effects of climate change can be seen in the America because temperature rises to as high as 50. So this fluctuation between 50 to minus 50 is a very worrisome condition, and like Shahzad alluded to this fact before, that climate change is a man-made thing and we need to take care of our planet, we need to take care of our environment, and we need to make sure that we put and invest in this planet Earth, because this is the only planet which we are inhabiting. There is no other planet, and if the planet or the mother nature is dying, we are feeling the effects of that because we are all connected to it. We are all one. We are all synergized in this beautiful cosmic connection which is unfolding before our eyes. So make sure that you contribute your part in reducing your carbon footprint. And this is the topic of our today's segment, the climate change, its effects, and how in the winters we are going to cope with this entire condition that is unfolding before our eyes. So we are very glad that we have been joined by a former IG Forest. He happens to be Mr. Sayed Mahmood Nasir Saab. Assalamu alaikum, sir, and thank you so much for coming to our show.
Very good morning.
Right, so sir, we've seen that the temperatures are plummeting in Islamabad and Pakistan. We have, I think it was in October the last year, we witnessed the rainfall. And this is a very dangerous condition, and especially for the agricultural, because you're associated with the forestry segment. And we've seen in South Punjab, people especially who have the wheat crops coming up, they're very worried about, you know, how they're going to water their crops. So how do you explain this entire scenario, and what can be done to remedy that?
Yes, you are very clearly pointed out the problems associated with wheat crop and
the cycles, issues, the harvesting cycles.
And add one more, that and we are nearing end of January. This was the time over decades we would be planning for the spring tree plantation campaign. First or second week of February, the temperatures would be dropping, and the early spring breeze would be there, but this is almost reversed. And strange things are happening. Temperature in Murray, the hill station, are higher, and in Lahore they are lower.
Yes.
And because the Lahoreites are not seeing the sun for the last 1 month, and same is with Islamabad. And this is due to some changes in the climatic conditions because of so many climatic factors, and fog is the
right, sir. And does Pakistan has a plan to combat this climate change? Because we do have a very dedicated Ministry of Climate Change, and we had that ministry when the conversation regarding the climate change was not a thing as a pertinent discourse that it is now, right? So our state was brilliant enough to think about this entire phenomena that will unfold in the future, and we are seeing that, right? And is it working, the plan that the state has devised to combat climate change?
Yes, it is working, and they are... day by day, if you ask me what we were 40 years ago or even 20 years ago and what we are today, we are much in a better place to handle these crises. 20, 30, 40 years ago, the capacity was in the private sector. Now there is more capacity within the ministry.
Exactly.
This is what is the happening, and people in the ministry understand. And they are always working to develop device things to make things better.
Exactly. But sir, in addition to this, we really need to kind of talk about how Pakistan has been most vulnerable to climate change. Imagine that, you know, just previous year we have seen $40 billion of losses, and that because of the floods that we have witnessed. Not just that, I think in addition to this, you know, we talk about the 2010 floods, and then moving on, after every other alternate year we do witness floods over here. So when we talk about the policy, I guess that they, you know, we are an over-legislated country. We do have a lot of policies, but when it comes down to implementation, we need our international partners to kind of come together with us. Now, for a country which is not contributing 0.04% of contribution towards climate change, if we are to talk about it, and then being most vulnerable at the same time, and international partners not coming at par where they are certainly supposed to be the support system for the country, how do you think that we all alone can cope up with the changes of climate which are having very adverse effects on us?
This is a global problem, and every country tries to address it to according to its national circumstances.
True.
And we should have a two-pronged strategy, as one you have pointed out that we didn't cause it. But this discourse is now obsolete.
True.
Now it's the era of each country making its own commitments, voluntary commitments, and then taking actions to fulfill them. And that is called the NDC, Nationally Determined Commitments.
Yes.
And we have to have work domestically as well as internationally. And the good thing is that the real thing is that the provinces are taking up the matter seriously. They are building capacity of their own provincial institutions. So things are getting better.
But sir, when we say that things are getting better, it's not that, I do not want to be optimistic. I want to be positive myself. I'm a very positive person. Unfortunately for all of those people who were waiting for the Shadi season, this does not look like a Shadi season. It's too cold now.
True.
But while sticking to the topic, what I would love to talk about is that, you know, the recently COP28 took place as well. Now imagine that we had two guests over here who actually spoke about, they were from private industry, and we spoke about it, and they said that unfortunately we do not have those green projects with which we can get the funds which are to be disseminated for the climate change and the causes of climate change as well. How do you think that the government really needs to step up in the game where they come up with projects with which we can get those funds? We need those projects in the first place.
There is institutional arrangements are there. We have to make them a bit more inclusive and more transparent. Then a lot of capacity is available in the country. We, and especially the youth,
yep.
The generation, your generation of youth, which I can see, is far better equipped than of my generation or
right.
the generation prior to me. That is the optimistic thing that I can see.
Yeah.
Right, and I think that government has designed a lot of green projects and government has been getting grants for that, but it's about the international commitment and how they commit to it. But sir, let's talk about one of the pertinent problem that is interspersed with the discourse of climate change, that is the water security. And being someone who has been closely associated with the forestry, let's also talk about the wetlands, because wetlands is one of the smarter solution to tackling the water insecurity.
Yep.
Or the discourse of the climate change, right? So in, as a Pakistan, as a state, as a society, where are we standing in making sure that our indigenous communities are aware of this very, I would say, the blessing of the wetlands, because they are linked with the ecosystem of the forestry and entire things. So what are your views on that?
I can, you will hear a lot about it at the higher level. Let me explain it at a personal level.
Sure.
In 1997, I was working in Dera Ghazi Khan.
Yes.
In the forest. And we would go to the river Indus. It was still quite big, mighty river. And we would see, after 1 hour drive, one hunting party in the hunting season sitting for shooting ducks. And there were still so many wetlands in the private lands. And they were full of vegetation, and the ducks would land there, and you wouldn't be able to see them. So the hunters would devise techniques. Now I went there again after 30 years. After every 500 meters, there is a hunting party, and the migratory ducks coming all the way from Europe or Central Asia,
mm-hmm.
they don't have a spot to rest.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
They need to rest.
Okay.
And the same thing is when they go back.
Right.
And those wetlands, out of those which were there in 1997-98, only 10% are left.
Right.
So this is a big problem,
extent,
and
yes.
the poor people who live there in mm. the, who are the owners of that wetlands at that time, who didn't have money to utilize those wetlands, were just watching hunters coming to their wetlands to hunt. But now there are no more. They just invested, flattened the lands, and they are doing agriculture.
So, and there, is there any system or the law which has been devised by the government to protect the wetlands and the poaching that has been going on?
Unfortunately, there isn't any specific law for wetlands.
Right.
There is draft law,
okay.
Draft policy, I
yeah.
can say, but it is yet to be approved.
Yes.
And however, the good thing is that the Recharge Pakistan project, which
yes.
is a floodplain management project which we designed in the Ministry of Climate Change after the 2010 floods. It took so many years to design, to understand the concept and face the backlash from the engineers who always were working for having concrete structures, more dams to check floods. But this project was for flood welcome policy.
True.
Right.
Exactly. But sir, in addition to this, where Hajra actually pointed out about water security, I believe that water security plays a very pivotal role. Imagine that water security will actually lead us towards food security itself. You know, when we talk about a country where 40% of the GDP actually comes from agriculture, we certainly need to kind of invest our energy in it and we need to prioritize it. But when we talk about water security, we do know that how, you know, we're way short of water as a country ourselves. And this is something that we really need to work on. Now, imagine that you're a country which is so prone to floods, that wetlands, we're talking about them as well, but we have been unable to, you know, have that water security for ourselves, even though that we are so prone to floods.
Yes, we need to harmonize our water policy with the climate change policy and have a wetland policy.
So everything needs to come under one umbrella.
Yes, and because climate change is now becoming so serious that your very existence is at questionable.
True.
But you mentioned about the Recharge Pakistan and one of the projects which our state has devised to make sure that we tackle the very recurring problem of the floods. Yet 2 years ago, we witnessed a very surge in the floods, and we know that any policy would be unable to deal with the upsurge of the water that set into our country. But let's talk about some of the gaps or what are the talking points or what are some of the things about this Recharge Pakistan which you devised as someone closely linked with
the ministry. It's about you know, giving floods enough room as it was designed by nature. We are basically a floodplain country. Right in the north is the mighty Himalayas, and in the south is the Arabian Sea, and in between the rivers flow. And we have to respect nature, and the rivers would not only bring water but would also bring nutrition from the volcanic and other soils from the mountains, rich soils. And if those floodplains would produce a lot of vegetation, lot of you know, crops, but because of the dams, we were looking at one aspect of the dams and the barrages about regreening deserts in the north. But we were forgetting that this same water was also bringing you know, mangrove forests, millions of acres of mangrove forests. So we need to rationalize, and the main purpose of this project is that give living space to the rivers, to the floods, so that they get time to percolate in the ground and then recharge the groundwater, which is now dwindling at a very fast pace.
And
another beauty of the floods is that once they enter a polluted lake, pond, they just flush it, and they, after 1 year, the water becomes you know, high quality drinking water. But if we don't, then we keep on living with the poisonous water.
And I think that is the best example of the Kanjur Lake, especially which is located in the Sindh, because a lot of people, and they're actually the scientific studies that are pointing out that how polluted it has become. But now, sir, let's talk about the importance of mangrove forest. And you mentioned that they play a very vital role in the natural ecosystem. But we see that they are dwindling and they're depleting at a very fast pace, because they're also the nurseries for the shrimps and the local communities, the fishermen. They sell the shrimps for their income, right?
There's an ecosystem.
Yes, so their livelihood is associated with the protection of the mangrove forest. But we see the corporates, and we see all of these big giants, they are, I mean, deforesting the mangrove forest because they don't look very fancy. So how can we protect mangrove forest and make sure that the local community claim the ownership of those forests?
There is good news about that. The you are right that some people are cutting those forests, but overall there has been a tremendous increase in the mangrove forests in Pakistan because of continuous efforts at the one side. But you know, we don't give due acknowledgement, it's the 2010 onwards heavy floods that have been bringing a lot of water and lot of fresh water and silt, which is giving, you know, living space to the mangrove trees that they could come on their own.
So wow. Nature is protecting the nature. This is such a beautiful thing, especially to witness in the nature. But when we talk about the floods, and especially I was watching some news about Saudi Arabia and how it was a desert, but now because of the climate change, it has become a green again. True. And we see, especially I think in Pakistan, especially in the Punjab's southern area, how it was a desert, but it has been turned into a green land because of the floods, right? So there's an opportunity in the aftermath of the flooding, yes. right? So what sort of the opportunities are there, especially in the floods that we witnessed in 2022, and how can we convert that massive loss into an opportunity as a nation?
We have to follow what actually there were huge floods in China.
Yes.
And they went to Netherlands to learn from them. And then we in Pakistan, on the advice of the Ramsar mm-hmm. Convention on Wetlands, we went to China to learn from them.
Yeah.
And
they learned.
And then that's what helped us design the Recharge Pakistan project. And what we learned from the Chinese is that the cost of flood protection is quite is more
right.
than flood welcome. Just give flood living space, give it you know, time to percolate the soils, let it flow to the ocean, and you reap multiple benefits.
Exactly. But sir, in addition to this, you know, there's one more thing. As a Pakistani, we would always want ourselves to be very proactive with our approach. Now imagine that, you know, every time that we have been in conversation with you know, our guests from National Disaster Management Authority or other management authorities of such causes, imagine they've always shared with us that we do not have a proactive approach. Now imagine that you're vulnerable, that you know that, you know, there are going to be floods as well. So imagine, for reference, I would kind of mention about Japan over here. So imagine Japan, they do know that they're vulnerable to a lot of earthquakes, and they build back better. You know, the kind of structures that they're building are actually prone to handling whatever sort of earthquakes which is going to come
yes.
in as well.
Yes.
Now imagine, as a country like Pakistan, why can't we have a proactive approach towards all of these menaces which will come our way, and we know, but we sit like a pigeon most of the time, eyes closed. Once it's going to come, that's when we are going to start to work. Why can't we change this policy from being really proactive?
Oh, that's more of a political question than a scientific.
But you know, as an individual, this is something that we would want, right?
This is really a problem, and we have to find a way to resolve this problem.
And in addition to this, that, you know, we are contributing to this problem as well. Now imagine that, you know, Pakistan had vast lands which were purposely there for agriculture. Imagine that everybody or anybody who had, you know, agricultural land, they are now planning to have a society on top
of it. Oh, yes.
There's no stopping. And imagine that we, with that kind of industry, are even contributing towards climate change. So whatever, you know, maybe 0.04% even, but we are still contributing. We're not those, not stopping those malpractices.
You're right, and but there is also another side of it, that every Pakistan has, this is a good thing that we have the ability to criticize our own selves.
Yeah.
But imagine, the just this week I was sharing a small event that somebody went to the GT Road to restore old banyan tree.
Okay.
And I shared what we are doing with some international friends to find a response from an Indian who was saying, oh, you are doing great work, you are rising and we are devolving. And I told him that we think you are rising and we are devolving.
Yeah.
So this is this keeps on happening.
I think we need to think good about ourselves and make sure that we do the good. This is the one of the beautiful lessons that we learn in our conversation. So
yeah.
Thank you so much, sir, for coming here, for
Thanks.
Having this wonderful conversation regarding the climate change. And I think one thing that stands out is that it is also not just the responsibility of the state. Obviously, it is the responsibility of the state to deal with the menace of climate change, but it also diffuses to the individual responsibility of
True.
Making sure that you are also playing your part in a more cleaner and green environment, and your individual carbon footprint is reduced, because at the end of the day, this is the Mother Earth, this is the nature and the planet Earth, and we have only one planet to live. Because if there is no planet, if we have degraded it to such an extent that it can't be recovered, so it will definitely affect us. And with that, we are going on a short break.
But before we, very sorry, but before we actually go out for a short break as well, there's one small thing which I would love to add over here, and that is that
for people who might even think that they, you know, that they will be able to live on other planets, Quran in three different surahs has actually mentioned that this is that one planet that you can, that humans can survive. Probably, you know, if you go to other planets, you will need a lot of other things to kind of establish as well. But very quickly, towards the end of this segment, there's one small thing on a lighter note, and that is that, so imagine that with December, you know, there was a lot of romanticism, you know, people would go out, people would love to have coffee, sit at a coffee shop and whatnot. Imagine that romanticism is gone now because it's too cold. You're like, okay, yeah, we cannot step outside the house. And I've seen people, so imagine earlier if in my gym, you know, there were 50 people at one point of time, now there's only 5 or 6, and they really need that courage to kind of be out there as well. I think that's something which has, which is the kind of impact that I've seen of climate change as well. So ladies and gentlemen, you know, Hajra very rightly pointed out that as an individual, we really need to kind of make sure that our carbon print is on the lower side, you know, please, because we might not be able to avoid it. I think what we can do is that we can make smart choices. Be smart, all right? We're heading out towards a short break. Don't go anywhere, because when we come back, we have another amazing segment and an amazing guest waiting to speak to us. I've been waiting anxiously to speak to her as well. Don't go anywhere. We will be right back. Good morning.
Welcome back, and before going on to the break, we were talking about protecting our earth, protecting our environment, and making sure that everyone lives a good and a healthy life. But and in now segment, we are going to talk about, when we talk about protecting the environment, we are also going to talk about how can we protect the environment in terms of the legality, and what sort of actions, what sort of policies, and what sort of legal remedies are available, especially to the people out there. And we will also talk about the question of the gender justice and how gender plays an important role, and especially when it comes to the diversity in the senior judges. Or if this is a question, and it is a very interesting debate, that does the gender impact the quality of the justice meted out to the people out there? Because we often hear this term that law is blind, right? Law does not care about any particular justice. So if there are more gender diverse judges, if there are more women judges on the senior high courts and the senior in the senior cuisine, so how it is going to affect the delivery of the justice? And this is a very interesting question, and we are very glad that we have been joined by one of the true beauty with the brains in our studio. She has graced us with her presence. She happens to be a senior partner, SNS Law Associate. She's also the chairperson committee of the Legal Awareness for Islamabad High Court, and she also happens to be a legal advisor. She is Ms. Siba Farooq. Assalamu alaikum, and thank you so much for coming to our show.
Wa alaikum assalam, and thank you for having me on your show.
Exactly. Wonderful. Thank you so much. You know, it's an honor. Thank you so much for gracing the occasion as well. But in addition to this, you know, where Hajra has rightly pointed out that the kind of debate that we are going to have, and that is that of the, you know, that when we talk about gender equality, and that too for people, you know, who dispense justice. Yes. Now imagine, I think it was on 24 January 2022 that first ever female judge was appointed a judge for the Supreme Court as well. Now when we talk about it, do you think that it's more of there shouldn't be more men but then more women, or it's more about the quality of judges that we really need to witness in dispensing the law?
You're absolutely right. It's been 2 years now that Honorable Justice Aisha Malik was appointed, and it was a big day for Pakistan. In the region, if we look towards our neighbors, we have about seven female judges in Bangladesh and about 3 in India. So we are far behind in the region.
But they are a population of 1 billion. You know, so 3 judges for them, we are a population of 24 crore.
We are, but for a population of 24 crore and a large proportion of that being women, women representation is very important, as is the representation of all minorities. So women have special women sensitive issues, which is why even in the constitution of Pakistan, they are protected, and there need to be special laws for the protection of women. So now when the constitution says that there needs to be special protection, special laws for women, and there needs to to be equality for citizens, then we need the special sensitivities in place. And sometimes even only women can provide those, can handle those women sensitive cases, which is why we always say that there needs to be, now this is a global concept, it is not just for Pakistan, that there need to be women representation in parliament, there needs to be women representation in the judiciary, there should be women representation in every profession. There is women representation here. We have one male host and one beautiful female host. So that adds substance, and it is also the requirement. Because you see, I'll give you a very simple example.
Sure.
Cases related to domestic violence.
Yes, because of the policy.
Cases related to, sorry.
Yeah, yeah. Because of the paucity of the time, because you mentioned a very important landmark case, which was about the marital rape, right?
Yes.
And let's discuss this, because when I talked about that, how the gender of the, whether the gender of any judge will dictate the outcomes of the law or the justice that has been dispensed.
But so that's not how it should be.
Yeah, I mean, but when she talked about, you know, women are more sensitive to the needs of women because they are going through maybe some of the problems, or they understand it or comprehend it better.
That's where my disagreement is, because imagine that law needs to be by the book. It does not need to be how sensitive you feel about it.
Right, right. So let's talk about the case of the marital rape, and that man was sentenced up to 3 years in the jail, and that has been labeled as a landmark judgment, right? So why it is being labeled as the landmark judgment? Because do you believe in it was given by a male judge or a female, you know, judge that was sitting on the judiciary?
It's very interesting that you should bring that up. So I read in the paper again and again that it is a landmark judgment.
True.
I do not agree with that. Okay. Now I will explain to you why it is not a landmark
judgment. It's going to occur more and more now, I think that's what it is.
Sorry?
It's going to occur more and more now, unfortunately.
Yes, but actually, the problem here is that the man was actually not charged for rape. Okay. He was not charged under Section 375, which is the offense of rape, and for which the punishment can be from death up to 25 years. But he was not charged under that. He was charged under Section 377, unnatural offences. Now, this is something very interesting. Why we need more female judges? Because as such in society, there is a lethargy and there is a inclination not to address issues where it's the marriage, where the problem is within the marriage.
I'm really sorry. I know that you know that you're a very capable lawyer, and I do not want to argue with you, but what I'm trying to convey over here is that, you know, when we talk about women judges, we do need them, but we cannot say that they can be, or they should be, more sensitive towards cases which are affiliated with women. I think that it needs to be by the book. That's why that we have a book as well. And we cannot say, kyunki ji ek aurat hai to wo dusri aurat ka jo hai na wo zyada ehsaas karegi. Us tarah to phir judge ki jo bhi dispensation hogi, whatever dispensation of the law or the justice is, it's going to be biased.
So you see, over here we have a few things that we need to keep in mind. You're talking about the ideal world.
Obviously, that's what we are supposed to talk about.
We should be moving towards the ideal world where there is no gender.
Let me change the question, or let me put it this way. Do you think that male judges, okay, so this is just a question, I'm not trying to, you know, imply anything onto anybody. Do you think that male judges, unfortunately, are, you know, what you're trying to present over here is insensitive about cases related to women?
I didn't say that. What I'm trying to tell you is this, that we need female judges, more representation of female judges, because women make a very large part of our population.
But then the basis needs to be merit now.
Yes, we are not saying that
there
should not be merit.
There is patriarchy here. I mean, you can't deny that.
I'm not at all am I saying that. Okay. I'm saying that they should have equal opportunity on the basis of merit. Because there are certain cases, there are certain problems which are related to women, which women understand better and are in a better position to give justice towards to those. I'm coming back to the case that I was talking to you about. Do you know why there was a research, there are at least 30 to 40% marital rape occurrences in our society. However, very few are reported, and this is the first, they're calling this a landmark judgment because it's the first time in Sindh that marital rape has been convicted. Yet it has not been convicted under rape because there is a hesitation at the very onset. When you go to report a crime to the police station, you will often hear the police say, oh, this is an internal matter of marriage. We will not take it up. So the hesitation or the problem starts for the woman dealing with the male police personnel who are not as educated and as aware that they should be giving a merit-based response. So she cannot even register the case. Very few even get reported. And when they finally reach the courts are more inclined to bring them under section 377 or to give them a more lenient punishment. Whereas, to my mind, of course, the Honorable Judge knew best what he was doing, and a lot depends on evidence as well. But when it's marital rape, under our law, rape is not differentiated, whether marital or otherwise. But and the punishment is very strict.
And in addition to this,
yet,
you know,
they don't do that.
We need to kind of talk about this as well, because we're talking about gender equality over here as well. So imagine that, you know, when we talk about, you know, you talked about marital rape, and obviously, because I think that, you know, if unfortunately the incident is up to 40% that it's taking place as well, we need to talk about it. But why is it that that every time that we're going to talk about marital rape now, that all of a sudden the victim will be women? Why can't it be men too? You know, and imagine that if there's a lesser incidence of it, I think it's men that who might not have spoken about it, that whatever they might have gone through.
Fast forward this conversation and develop it furthermore, so we cannot deny the trickling effects of the patriarchy that is present in every institution.
Obviously.
So for example, if we talk about the cybercrime laws, or if you know, women, their photos are being leaked online and there's some blackmailer who's harassing them and into coaxing him, her into doing, you know, some of the activities which are labeled under the blackmail. So, and if she goes and complains to any institution, so you will feel the effects of that, because the first thing that will come under the question is the character of that woman, right? So we cannot deny this thing that, you know, when we talk about the gender equality, when we talk about the gender discrimination, yes, women have been a marginalized group or segment in our
particular society.
But most of the
videos which we see which are leaked are of men. You know, they're hardly of women.
So no, I think this is your personal and a very subjective judgment. It is not an objective
assessment. You guys don't care about men. That's something which I'm trying to establish.
So I think we let
I will remind you of a very recent incident, unfortunate one, that took place in the Islamia University in Bahawalpur.
Yeah, that was unfortunate.
It was not one man, not one boy.
True.
Numerous young girls. You know, jokes aside,
that
we
happened
cannot
in Balochistan University.
We cannot, we have to first change the mindset of society, and we have to start addressing all of these issues, because it is true that the female population, let's not only think about the urban
cities, rural as well.
Let's also think about rural. Let's also think about the problems that they are facing, which is from their schooling to them facing domestic violence, to problems they face in seeking medical care. There are a host of problems. There's so many and they're so horrifying. And a lot, you know, I get a lot of cases because I have made a few law talks. I do these regular law talks for social media, and on that, once I uploaded a video about cybercrime, and you would be surprised the number of 18-year-old girls that reached out to me from various cities, and they were scared even to share with their parents and the way they were being blackmailed on social media. And then, of course, now we have FIA being very, very proactive. They're reaching out into the district. They have this response organization, national response organization, and they are handling these cases very proactively. But it is a new instance of crime that is just coming like a wave, and that wave is attacking women far more than it is attacking men.
That's true.
That's just the way that it is.
And for the awareness of people, you know, unfortunately earlier, you know, if it was videos and everything, now imagine that, you know, there was this unfortunate incident where this picture of this lady went viral with a guy, you know, who was this guy wasn't her husband, obviously. So her husband actually kind of killed her as well, unfortunate. And now imagine that picture was generated on a software. They put two pictures together and posted it, it viral. And now imagine that lady is not alive anymore. So it's most of the times these days, it's artificial intelligence which can create WhatsApp conversations with your number, just the way you type. So people really need to be careful about it.
And I think deep fake is such a peril, and then we need to have more conversation with these, deep fake videos and deep fake audios that are being generated. But because of the paucity of the time, I think let's carry forward this conversation more, and let's talk about the domestic abuse that has been going on, especially about the domestic servants or the helpers that are working there. They're very vulnerable. Obviously, they're coming from a very not so good socioeconomic status, and then the way they are being exploited, they do not have lots of remedies, and the awareness might not be there. And also their parents sometimes forces them to work because they need money, right?
They cannot even afford having a lawyer as well.
So what does the law state in this regard, and how can those victims, obviously the power of social media is good, but there has to be something that law has to do, right?
You know, this is something that is such a big problem in our country, and I'm so glad that you are highlighting this on your show. It's almost in every household. We have had very serious cases come before us, but then we've had some very good judgments as well. It was the an honorable judge's wife who had to face trial because of the domestic abuse of a little girl. Now, the message that needs to go home or go out to the public is that under the law, you know, the laws are in place. It's just that people don't know about it. Do you know that under the law, we are not even allowed to call them servant? It's not allowed. The law does not allow you
That's very interesting.
However, refer to them as
you're supposed to refer to them as house help.
Domestic
or
help.
Every domestic help, because every profession needs to be respected. It is world over, it is not respected here. We need to call out when underage children are being made to work in a houses. But then again, while I say this, you and I both know that it ties into so many other problems. Like you said, there's poverty, there's economic instability, people don't have work. Then it ties into something else which is very, very big, which is the problem of population. People have people who cannot afford, are living below the minimum wage rate, who are living below the poverty line, have a line of 6 to 7 children. Now again, we will again tie that into the thinking of the society where they say, if we don't have a son, we must keep producing for the sake of having another son. And all of these problems are so interlinked. And again, going back to the point that most of them are interlinked to a patriarchal mindset. Most of them are interlinked to men not being as educated as they should be.
That's true.
And if they are really, if we are able to change the mindset of men in this country, we will be able to eradicate most of these problems.
Inshallah, inshallah. And you know what you just mentioned, I think I'll have to agree to it, because this is something that I might have witnessed myself. And you know when you work around places, I think this is something which is very evident as well. Which actually brings me back to that very question, because I kind of mentioned about 24 January 2022, the first honorable female judge was appointed in Supreme Court as well. When we speak of it, what is the criteria of, for anybody to become the judge of the Supreme Court? So what is the criteria? Because what I have heard from my advocate friends is, I can be wrong, which is why I'm going to talk about it over here, because we learn over here every single day. And they said that it's the recommendations of other judges with which you can become a judge. Is that true?
Okay, so there is a lot of debate on the criteria as well. There's an entire movement called Women in Law, who are pushing for more understanding of who can be a Supreme Court judge. And right now we are lucky to have two judges in the Supreme Court, two honorable judges. Although seniority is considered as the criteria, however, according to the law, it's actually not.
Okay.
So it is merit. And yes, recommendation matters. Yes, your...
So there's no exam or anything? Or
no.
Nothing.
For a Supreme Court judge, there is no...
is that it?
Dua karenge kisi din.
Inshallah.
But the... time in the High Court goes into consideration. Either they should have spent about, if I'm right, 5 years as a High Court judge or 15 years as a lawyer, senior lawyer standing. So these criteria matter. But there is an understanding that it is just seniority. No, actually, it is not just seniority.
Right,
so
I think
these
that we
are
might
all very interesting things. These are, and they're long, long, interesting debates. And I think the honorable judges now are, you know, taking it into consideration and bringing more women.
And I think she has wonderfully presented her case, being a lawyer herself. She has debated wonderfully well. And thank you so much, Ms. Sibha, for coming here, for having this wonderful cross-pollination of ideas on gender justice, on the issues of the justice delivery, and how we can make this society a more gender inclusive one, a more prosperous one, and where there is a speedy dispensation of the justice. Because as the old adage goes on, justice delayed is justice denied. And we have debated and we have heard immense debates and profound debates on this concept. So with that, we will bid you farewell. Allah Hafiz. Until next time.
It's a good morning. Look after yourselves. Bye bye. Thank you.